We aim to give them confidence and everything to society. So we do lots of things like mobility, cookery, recreational study.
What does mobility training consist of?
When we begin, this is just around the goal and the ground. We gradually expect the child to do more on their own, more finger around. Then we will take them into town and they will be trained to walk around, shop, do their own shopping, build up their confidence as they move, so that when they leave us, they can take their place in normal society.
Now, we'll interpret for Stephen.
Right,
today, we've got a longer walk because we've put the vans here. Now today, I want you all to go around that way to, first of all, to the bridge, to Woolworths, through Woolworths, to the station, so you go over the lights.
On a light.
Right. To the station, then back to Littlewoods for your coffee.
On your way then.
On your way then, okay. Right. Now you've got to go around that way.
Where's Alistair?
And remember, young man, come here. You walk slowly. You walk slowly. So you don't walk into people. All right? Remember. You go to Woolworths first, then to the station, and back to Littlewoods. Right, go. Off you go. And then, careful, Woolworths first, then the station afterwards, then Littlewoods for your coffee. Right, go. Right?
Yeah.
Do you know the way? To Woolworths and the lights, yes, and back to Littlewoods. Right. You go after Laura.
Tomorrow for the children. Sports day, yes. And can you remember what things you do? What things do you do at sports day? Running and jumping and long jump, yeah? Three-legged race, yes? Which game do you like the best at sports day?
Why did your fish die? 45p for a new fish. The name of the shop to buy your fish. What is it? No, the name of the shop. The pet shop. How much money?
Do you have enough money with you? Yes?
How much? How much money? 57 pence. How many fish? Five?
What tends to happen to most of the children when they leave school?
Mostly they just look forward to leaving here to go anywhere else. As if they had any expectations at all, they are used to a higher they cannot achieve. Like working in a normal wood on a farm or working with animals in other ways. They never seem to think about the repetitive jobs in factories, although we do have a workshop here where they do lots of little jobs that they would be doing on an assembly line. But they don't tend to think of that as their future. They often seem to think that they can do anything that the normal person can. There are times when we have to explain to them in great detail why they cannot drive cars and ride motorbikes.
Any social occasion, it's hello, how do you do? All those introductions, I never miss my cue.
To few people. A dove. Oh, what race the type will have an accident to? Oh, not afraid to come on the buck. But I have always kicked up to hard up to such resistance. To me doing things like this. I said, I am my own judge of what I can and can't do.
Shake those hands!
I enjoy travelling at speed, especially if I am driving myself. I feel quite safe, so long as someone on the back I can trust. I know how to tell me which way to go. I am not worried in the least.
Anything you would like to do with your bikes that you haven't done so far?
Would I like to be able to do more jumping over obstacles? I have done it in the past successfully. usually things like tree trunks that looking flattered aren't a clear across the surface.
Do you feel that having to rely on other people so much affects your self-esteem?
Yes, it can certainly do that too. I am unable to make a friend's and to go out with them as I would like to. But the Hasicom project has made a great deal of difference. I used to have to ask somebody if they would ring a friend and speak to them and tell me, they said, as this is hardly independent. But now I can pick up the telephone myself, connect it to the computer, and speak to people who are on the system.
The signal I am making is telling the computer I am here and would like to make a connection. I have to identify myself. I'm through now with the time I signed on. And letters, and number of letters, and so on.
Number of letters from other people. For you.
Yes.
In the computer.
May I call 14 red, 4 unread, 1 unread, express.
Can you show me how you key information in and how you read it out?
I write on a little keyboard like an ordinary braille machine. The words appear on the braille display and are also recorded on the cassette tape. John Lee has been interpreting for me. John Lee has been interpreting for me. Full stop.
I have to take your word for that.
What does it say? What does it say? Read it to me. Dear David.
I hope that in time, the system will spread, that all organisations for handicapped people will be on the system, and that to our friends will have the opportunity to have a visual display unit at our home so that we can talk to them as well.
and I live in my dreams. I make it better than it seems today. Down out higher than clouds, and I'm living in sound. I'll make it better than it seems today. Is in this world, I gotta give a laugh a world today. Higher than the clouds, wrapped up in the sound. I'll make it better.
Countryside, I can smell the grass or flowers. Or I know the car passes because I usually smell it. Smells mostly what the scents I could use. And of course, I can feel the horse move. Lovely feeling. His name's Jasper. We seem to get on very well, really. We'd have them in the start. Sometimes you don't get on with the horse, which has happened to me, and then it's not much fun. But if you hit it off straight away, it's great, because you work as a team.
Would you like a horse of your own?
Oh, yes. I'd love my dreams to have an Arab. Very, very expensive, though.
Do you live alone?
Yes, with my dog.
Alone with your dog?
Yes.
What's his name?
She's a rough collie called Lassie.
Is she a guide dog?
Not officially, no, but she will lead me when necessary. She's mostly a close companion. I don't look on her as a pet. She's more than that to me. She's my whole world.
Your wife, Enid, is partially deaf and blind too. How do you cope at home?
Not too bad. Whenever you have some kind of trouble getting about in the place, in the room, sometimes we bump into each other because she's blind and one eye, really. But can see a bit and do that. And also, when I go looking for something on the floor, I go down on the floor to feel for them, and she steps into my finger sometimes, stepping over backwards into my finger. Mm.
So you get 10 broken fingers?
Nearly.
And bruises all over?
Yes.
Do you ever get depressed? About your handicap?
Yes, I do. Because, well, mostly because I know what I'm missing. Also, I feel I don't meet the sort of people I'd like to meet.
So what sort of people would you like to meet?
People of my own age, mainly, or thereabouts, that more or less endure the same sort of things as I do, and also like having fun.
So do you think that forming friendships and relationships is a different or more difficult process for deafblind people?
It can be, yes. It depends on individual people, really. It just depends how you are. I can find it difficult because some people are a bit worried about how to communicate. Communication's the main problem. Some people, I think, can be put off or are really too scared to try. What they don't realise is I'm probably just as scared of them as they are of me.
Too many people are frightened to touch someone, and of course we're reliant upon touch. And certainly an English person, Northern European, they don't go in for touching each other very much during conversation. And I find that people from other cultures are much more relaxed about this and more able to communicate with deafblind people because they're not so frightened of physical contact, which of course we need, because it is our means of communication.
For a person like me, an essential part of falling in love is being able to see and hear the object of my affections. How does someone who is deaf and blind form that sort of relationship?
I think we mostly have our own ways of deciding what a person looks like. Not their face or figure, maybe the shape of their hands, whether we feel comfortable when they're doing the manual or not, the way we get on together, whether we can have serious talks and have our laugh together. I can't think of anything else apart from very little things.
So there are attractive and unattractive hands.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Hope you like mine.
It's not bad for a man's hand.
Thank you.
I have the 14 my mind, other thing tried my foot, but I thought to move the bucket to work place like London, or where transport still exists. If the doctor was it raised, then that wouldn't have by any chance of proper independence. If the government succeeds in demolishing the GLC, and therefore a London transported or will fall into the hands of a government committee, as it will be drastically cut back, stations will be closed, and fewer buses and trains will run. And also, as it is very likely that a handicapped people who at this moment are entitled to free travel on London transport services, or would then have to pay. And many of these people are either at this moment unemployed or on very low wages, and certainly can't afford the kind of fares that Mrs. Fletcher was insisting on.
When you need to ask for help, does it upset you in any way to have to rely on other people?
Not now. I think everyone, handicapped or not, has to rely on others in one way or another. The way I have to rely on them may just be a little more unusual.
But quite acceptable to you?
It has to be if I want to go on living.
You have been deaf
and blind for most of your life.
Yes.
What do you think you would have done
if you hadn't
been
deaf and blind?
Blind. I think I would have, and I would have done more than what I've done, been doing now. I think that I would have liked to have done things like traveling all over the place, all over the world, traveling.
How do you feel about that?
Now, as a deafblind person, well, it is not the most to feel about, really. But being deaf and blind, you are more in an empty place. You don't feel that you are going anywhere different at all. It seems to be the same, except that you know that you have got something around you, like bubbles or paper. But if you were to go in a car and take somewhere else and then put it down, it will be the same thing to me. The ground the same. No difference.
So one place is like another?
It is. To me it is.
What religion, if any, do you have?
I'm a Church of England, really. But I'm always friendly towards anybody, whatever religion they are.
So what do you actually believe?
I believe in life after death. Like reincarnation. And there is nothing that could make me believe that there is no life in it, because if there was no life after that, it would be impossible to understand how people could have become alive from the past. There must be a reason for being born, so if you die, you must be born again soon.
If you would like a Braille transcript of this programme, please write to Community Programme Unit, BBC TV, London W12 8QT. We'd like to remind viewers that the next edition of See Here, our regular programme for the deaf, will be shown next Sunday lunchtime at 12:05 and on Monday at 2:25 on BBC One.